Will I stop us? We'll pray together. Heavenly Father, we bless your name for the Bible study tonight. We thank you because you brought us together so you can teach us, and so that your word will do great things in every life. We're asking, Lord, that tonight you teach us yourself by your Spirit in Jesus. Lord, your word seriously.
We will take your word seriously, and it will turn us in the right direction to the way of the cross in Jesus' name. Touch every heart, transform our lives, and help us to be the people you want us to be, people who are saved, people who are truly sanctified, and people who have the power of the Holy Ghost to carry out the truth of your word in Jesus' name. Increase us in our love. Our love towards you. Our love towards your word. Our love towards everything that belongs to you. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. And somebody there says, amen. God bless you. You can see that we're coming to Revelation chapter 2. For those who are coming for the first time, I'm so happy to find that we have quite a number of people coming for the first time. The book of Revelation is a wonderful book, and it's a very deep book. And it has a lot for those who are studying for the first time, and a lot for those who have been studying the Bible for a long time. And you're going to find today that Christ is speaking to everyone. He's speaking to those who are part of the church, and he's speaking to those who are still to come by grace into the fold, into the kingdom. Today we're looking at chapter 2, and I'm reading from verse 1. Revelation chapter 2 verse 1, unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, this six is he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. You're going to find as you look at the book of Revelation that a lot of symbols, and you need to understand the symbols so that you can understand the message that is being symbolized. You can understand the message that Christ himself, the head of the church and the savior of his people, that is sending to you, sending to me, sending to everyone. Now he's writing to the angel of the church. You get to understand that later. Look at verse 2. Look at what he says to that church. He says, I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear with them which are evil. But, and thou hast tried them which say the apostles and are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne, and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored, and hast not fainted. Here Jesus Christ spoke to that church, and he says, I know your works, I know your deeds, I know your life, I know your labors. I know all the characteristics of that church. He knew them from the leadership to the membership. He knew them from the greatest to the smallest. He knew them from the men to the women. He knew them from the public to the private. He knew every one of them, and he knew who they were and what they were. And he began to itemize one by one. And he says, I know this about you. I know this about you. I know this about you. And there were good things, practical things, highly exalted things, and positive things. Now, he's going to find out something, and he's going to reveal something to them that they should have known, but they didn't take note of that, so he was going to point it out to them. Look at verse 4. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Many good things about this church, the church to the Ephesians, the church of the Ephesians, and yet this one singular thing, this one solitary thing, very important, did he keep at heart? He says, remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. after giving them that warning and after alerting them of what he had against them, he now comes back again to commend them. Look at verse 6. But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which thing I also hate. Now it's lifting up their eyes to the future and to the reward they're going to have when it gets to glory. Look at verse 7. It says, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the, tell me, to the churches, writing to the church at Ephesus. And it says, it's concluding now, and it says, this is not just for Ephesus. It says, anyone, anywhere, everywhere that has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to all the churches. To him that overcometh, I'll be an overcomer. To him that overcometh, will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. As you look at the flow of that message to Jesus Christ, to his own disciples, you're going to find here Christ's message to a devoted but deficient church. Christ's message to a devoted but deficient church. They were devoted to the Lord. They were devoted to the gospel. They were devoted to the standard of the word. They were devoted to what they believed about the Lord. And the Lord said that. He said, I know your devotion. I know your commitment. I know your dedication, because you have held on to the truth of the word of God. But all the same, even though they were devoted, they were deficient. And it says in verse 4, nevertheless, I have somewhat against you because of the deficiency I find there. As you look at chapters 2 and 3, it talks about the churches. The church in Ephesus, and the church in Smyrna, and the church in Pergamos, and the church in Sardis, and the church in Philadelphia, the church in Laodicea. The Lord is sending to these churches. And so consider the message all together from chapter 2 and chapter 3. Number 1, there is a primary application. Primary application. That is, the first people he sent the message to, the primary audience, he was sending the message to. Look at chapter 2 verse 1. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus. Right. That's the primary audience. And look at verse 8. It says, unto the angel of the church in Smyrna write. That's the primary audience. As you look at verse 13, it says, verse 12 rather, unto the angel of the church in Pergamos write. And then you come to verse 18, unto the angel of the church in Thyatira. Very definite, writing to those, Judges chapter 3 verse 1, and to the angel of the church in Sardis, right? And then you come to verse 7, and to the angel of the church in Philadelphia. You come to verse 14, to the angel of the church in Laodicea. So there is a primary application. And all these churches, one by one, the Lord itemized, the Lord categorized, and the Lord analyzed for them what their lives were. But not only a primary application, number 2, a present admonition. A present admonition. In each of those churches, after addressing the church of that time, now he addresses you, which is a present admonition for you and for me. Come back to chapter 2, and you will see that present admonition. Chapter 2, verse 7. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. He said, don't just throw this to the past. Don't throw it only to the officials. Everyone here, you believer, you leader of the church, and you members of the church, and the newcomers to it, says, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. That's the present admonition. Look at verse 11. In verse 11, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. You come to verse 17. In verse 17 it says, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. We're looking at verse 29. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. Chapter 3, I'm reading here from verse 6. It says in verse 6, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. Then you come to verse 13. In verse 13 it says, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says on those churches. Everybody, you read verse 22 now yourself.
He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. You see, he addresses each of those churches, and each of those churches he concluded by saying, yes, I've spoken to Ephesus, I've spoken to Smyrna, I've spoken to Thyatira, I've spoken to all those people now, but you, there is a present application as well as admonition for you. But then, number one, there is a primary application. Number two, there is a present admonition. Number three, there's a prophetic anticipation. Prophetic anticipation. It's not just that, well, these past people, that's the past, and the present people, that's the present, and then it's not talking about the future. Look at chapter 2 again. Come back to chapter 2, and we're looking at verse 7. In verse 7, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. To him that overcometh, it's going to the future now, will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. It's gone, it's taking us to heaven already, taking us to paradise already. And he's saying that there is a prophetic anticipation. As you're studying all these verses of scripture, and you're looking at all the churches, you're thinking, here I am, here on earth today, I'm thinking about the future, I'm thinking about paradise, I'm thinking about when the Lord shall come. And because of my listening to the word, reading the word, obeying the word, understanding the word, applying the word to my life, is going to take me to a place that is in the great beyond the paradise of God. Look at chapter 2, verse 11. In verse 11, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt in the second death. He's talking about the final time when the judgment will come. And you see what we're studying today, there is a practical primary application, there is a present admonition, but think about the prophetic side, the prophetic anticipation, that on the final day, those who really know the Lord, and those who love the Lord, and those who have followed after the Lord, they will not be hurt at that day of judgment. Look at verse 17, chapter 2. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. To him that overcometh, I must overcome. I will overcome. I can overcome. Why is the Lord repeating every time? He's saying, you come to the Bible study, look at the future. Everything you have learned, we're not just learning this to stuff our head with knowledge. It is so that we can do something about it, and we can live as He wants us to live. And then we know that there is a future, and there's a prophetic anticipation. That's why it says, to him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it. And we come to verse 25. In verse 25 it says, but that which thou hast, hold on till I come. Till I come, that's future. Till I come, that's future. Is the prophetic side of it, that it says, I came before I died for you on the cross of Calvary, and I gave my blood so that you can be saved, you can be sanctified and made holy and made pure, and then you can get ready, and you're getting ready for that final day. And it is the final day you'll be looking at, because it says what you have already, the experience you have, the salvation you have, the knowledge you have, the truth you have, the standard you have, you hold on until I come. He that overcometh, verse 26, and keepeth my words unto the end. Unto the end is looking at the future. It says you're not just looking at a present application, you're not just looking at a present admonition, you're looking at the prophetic anticipation. Because now it says, he that overcometh and keepeth my words unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations, and he shall rule there with a rod of iron. Is looking to the millennial reign. Already is going beyond even the time of the rapture, and going beyond the time of the great tribulation, and going beyond to the time of the millennial reign. And he says, he will reign, and you will reign with him. You'll be there in Jesus' name. He shall rule there with a rod of iron, as the vessels of a potter, shall they be broken to shavers, even as I received of my Father. And I I will give him, that's future, that's prophetic, and I will give him the morning star. We'll come to chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 4. That's the prophetic anticipation. Verse 4, thou hast a few names even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments, and they shall, that's future, prophetic anticipation, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment. I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. And then we come to verse 11. In verse 11, it tells us, behold, I come quickly, anticipating the future. Prophetic anticipation. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name. And then we come to verse 21. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne. It's raining already at that time. That's the future. He'll sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame, and I'm set down with my Father in his throne. And so you find, as we look at these two chapters, we're talking, number one, about the church that existed at that time, the church at Ephesus. And then we're talking about the personal application and the personal admonition and the present admonition that appears to everyone. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. And then we're looking at the future, and we're looking at the prophetic anticipation. Now, as we look at this, Christ speaks to the church, and he spoke to the church of Ephesus at this time, and he's speaking to this church, our own church here, and he's speaking to the end time church, and he speaks to the Christians till and at the end of his coming. He's speaking to everyone. Actually, when you read the whole, any part you read in the Bible, that's the attitude you ought to have. You ought to understand, yes, we're reading the epistle to the Corinthians, but he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. We're reading the epistle to the Galatians, but he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. We're reading the epistle to the Philippians. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. Who are reading the general epistle of Jude, and he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. He speaks to everyone. And as you come today, every word you hear will be of benefit to you in Jesus' name. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, I'm reading from verse 11. And now all these things happen unto them for examples, and they are reaching for our admonition. See that? They are reaching for our admonition. You know, all those people that, you know, the Bible wrote about from Genesis to Malachi, they are gone already. Why is the scripture then given to us? Why is the word given to us? The writings of the law, the writings of the Psalms, and the writings of the prophets. Why is everything given to us? So that we'll understand the ends of the world have come upon us, and then they are reaching for our admonition, for our instruction, and they're reaching for our teaching. They're reaching so that our lives will not be what it used to be. It says, upon whom the ends of the world are come. And since we are the people living at this time, and the end of the world is quite very near, the Lord is telling us, he's spoken to us, he's written the word, he sent the word, and we're going to abide by that word in Jesus' name. Somebody says a good amen. Amen. Christ's message to a devoted church. Christ's message to a devoted church, but a deficient church. There are 3 points we're going to look at. Number one, Christ's reassurance for a favored minister. Christ's reassurance for a favored minister. Here he gives a reassurance, and he says he's the one himself talking to the people. He's the one himself sending John to write to the people. It's Christ's reassurance. And I pray that the reassurance of the Lord will be in your heart, in your life today, in Jesus' name. Number two, Christ's recognition of a faithful ministry. At Ephesus, they carried out a faithful ministry. And this allows us to know what a ministry is, a Christian ministry, a gospel ministry, a ministry ministering to the people, a ministry according to the directives of the Lord, according to the standard of the Lord, according to the desires of the Lord, according to his own standard. Christ's recognition of a faithful ministry. Number three, Christ's requirement of faulty messengers and falling members. Christ's requirement of faulty messengers. Because it says, nevertheless, they pointed out the good things about you, nevertheless have somewhat against you, because you have left your first love. And then he told them, remember, and then repent and do the first works. He said, except you do that, I'll come and take the candlestick out of its place, except you repent. He was talking to the leader of that church, he was talking to the whole church, he was talking to the members of the church. Faulty messengers and falling members. Christ's requirement of faulty messengers and falling ministers. We come to number one. Christ's reassurance for a favored minister. Come to Revelation chapter 2 verse 1. Revelation chapter 2 verse 1. It says, unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write. Here is the Lord Jesus Christ himself. And he's saying that this message primarily, presently, is for the church at Ephesus. And then after that, of course, we've read it, it belongs to the rest of us in the church. But it says, unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, this thing says he. Who is this? Who is the one talking? He that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand. Not only that, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. As we look at that verse about Jesus Christ, he was giving assurance to the people in the church and the members of that church at Ephesus. He says, you know what? I'm in control. I'm the head of the church. He says, you know what? I'm in control and I'm present with you. Where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of them. He says, you know what? I'm walking around in the midst of the church. He says, you know what? I'm holding all those stars in my hand. He says, you know what? And even the seven stars and the seven golden candlesticks, I'm walking in the midst of them. Nothing escapes my vigilance. He's looking at the church and is looking at us, and that gave them reassurance. And they were a favored church. If you know anything about the church at Ephesus, Paul the apostle was there. He was there for 3 years. In fact, actually from that center of the Ephesian church, the gospel went to all of Asia Minor. Not only that, Apollos had been there. Not only that, Timothy had been there. It was a favored church. And now he said, look at chapter 2 verse 1, unto the, tell me the word there, unto the angel of the church of Ephesus. Who's this angel, by the way? Because it says unto the angel. Every time people see an angel, they see an angel about, they say, okay, that's an angel that came from angel that is taking care of them. It's like an heavenly personality, but not really. You cannot write a letter, an epistle to an angel and then post it to heaven. There's no postmaster to take that to heaven. It's talking about the minister of the church. It's talking about the leader of that church. You see, a leader of the church, an angel. And look at Galatians chapter 4. Galatians chapter 4, and I'm reading from verse 14. To the angel of the church in at Ephesus, right? It's writing to the leader of the church. Look at Galatians chapter 4, verse, tell me the verse. Verse 14, look at this. And my temptation, this Paul the apostle writing to them. And it says, and my temptation, it says in this, verse 14, which was in my flesh, ye despised not, nor rejected, but received me. The apostle Paul, received me, tell me there, as an angel of God, even as Christ Jesus. You see the church, the early church, when he saw their ministers, they said, that's our angel. That's our angel. Why did they refer to them as angel? Because they were ministering to them. Not only that, angels are high, the ministers were high. Angels are holy, the ministers were holy. Angels were heavenly, and these ministers were heavenly minded. Angels were obedient to the watch of God. God says, go, they go without asking question. And these ministers of God, they obeyed the Lord promptly, they obeyed the Lord completely, and they obeyed the Lord without question. Angels were faithful, and as they were faithful, you see Paul the apostle, he was a faithful minister. Angels were uncompromising. Whatever God sent an angel to do, they just went to do it without any compromise. And because of those qualities of life in the ministers of the church in the New Testament, they looked at them as angels. That's why it says, unto the angel of the church at Ephesus write. Now it says the church. What do you understand by the church? Because many times today, when you see a building, you say, that's such and such a church, that's such and such a church, that's such and such a church. We equate the building to the church, and we say the building and the church, the church is a building. What did they understand by the church at that time? Acts of the Apostles chapter 7. We're looking at verse 38. Acts of the Apostles chapter 7, and we're looking at verse 38. It says, this is he. He's talking about the people of Israel, and talking about their leader. He's talking about Moses. And he said, this is he, which was in the church in the wilderness. You see that word church there, which was in the church in the wilderness with the angel which spake to him in the Mount Sinai, and with her fathers who received the lively oracles to give unto us. Look at that. It says some people came out of Egypt, and they were going through the wilderness, and they were going into the land of promise, into Canaan land, and they referred to them as the church in the wilderness. What do you understand about the church? In the Greek word is ecclesia, the people who have come out, the people who are going through, the people who are getting into. Understand? That's the church. It's people, it's not building. It's people, it's not edifice. It's people, it's not a sanctuary. It's the people. Number one, they came out. Number two, they're going through in the wilderness. Number three, they're going in. And as you look at the church today, that's the understanding. When it says to the church of Ephesus, it's talking to people who have come out of the world. To the church, it's talking of the people who are going through as pilgrims in the world. And when it talks about the church, about the people that have the mind of getting to heaven. I want you to look at those three prepositions we'll call there. Out of, going through, and then into. We're looking at Jeremiah chapter 2. Jeremiah chapter 2, and I'm reading from verse 6. So you have an understanding when it says to the church, talking of the people, they came out of darkness, and they're going through this world, but they're not of the world. And they're going into paradise, the land of promise. They're going to heaven. We're looking at Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 6. Neither said they, where is the Lord that brought us up out of, underline that, out of the land of Egypt, and led us through, that's the word through, through the wilderness, and through a land of deserts and of pits, and through a land of drought and of the shadow of death, and through a land that no man passes through, and where no man dwelt. Look at verse 7. And brought you into a plentiful country. See those propositions there? Out of, through, And then into, that's the church, the people who come out of the world, and the people who are going through this wilderness of a world, and the people who are getting into heaven. Look at 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2, talking about the church, the called out people, out of sin, and they're going through this world, they've come to the Savior. Out of darkness, and they're going through this wilderness of the world, and they're going to heaven. And then it's out of the clutches and the captivity of Satan, and they're going through because they're free. God has set them free through Christ, and they're going to heaven. In 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 9, but she a chosen generation, that's the church. A royal priesthood, that this church, and a holy nation, that's the church, a peculiar people, that's the church, that you should show forth the praises of him who has called you, tell me, out of, that's it, out of darkness, and then tell me the next thing there, into his marvelous light. That's the church, that's the church. They're called out. They're going through the world, and then they're getting into. And then when it says the church, those are the people, they're saved people. And there are people who just attend the service. There are people who just name the name of a denomination. That's not part of the church. Acts of the Apostles chapter 2. Acts of the Apostles chapter 2. And we're reading here from verse 47. Praise God. And having favor with all the people. And the Lord, see this, and the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. When you come out of your sin, and then you know the Lord as your personal Savior, and you can point to the day, the time that you say, I repented. I remember it took place in that place. I had the word of God. I was convicted of my sin. I went on my knees. I got up. By the time I got up, I felt the forgiveness. I knew the forgiveness. Jesus Christ forgave my sins. He died for me on the cross of Calvary. And now I have the peace of God. And I have that righteousness that he gave me. And I still remember the day, I still remember the place, and I thank God because he saved me, called me out of sin. And now I'm walking through this world, but I'm not part of the world, and I'm going to heaven, and that's part of the church. I pray the Lord will effect it in your life in Jesus' name. And let's come back to Ephesians, to Revelation chapter 2 verse 1. Unto the angel, that's the leader, unto the angel, that's a minister, unto the angel, that's a pastor there, unto the angel of the church, angel, is that singular or plural there? Tell me out loud. Singular. There are some people that tell us that, you know, leadership in the church should be pluralistic. That is, all the church should be led by a committee of people. No, Christ does not say that. It says to the leader, singular, to the angel, singular, to the minister, singular, of the church of Ephesus, right? And then he tells us now, what's he going to write? These things says he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand. Holdeth the seven stars in his right hand. What does that mean? There are, you know, in the night, when you look up like this, you see the star, you see the moon. And what's the Lord saying here? Is he saying that he's holding the stars of the sky? Not really. Look at chapter 1, verse 20. Chapter 1, verse 20. The mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks. The seven stars are, tell me, the angels of the seven churches. The seven stars are the ministers of those seven churches, and the seven golden candles, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. Again, those angels are called stars. Those ministers are called stars. Why do they call them stars? You know, you understand when we say star, that's like a champion, like that's like a hero, that's like somebody you put up there and you want to follow, and you want to say, that's a star, that's a champion, that's a hero. I want to follow a person like that. What did he call the ministers, the angels of those churches? What did he call them stars? We're looking at Daniel chapter 12. Daniel chapter 12, and I'm reading from verse 3. Daniel chapter 12, verse 3. And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament. And they that turn, tell me, many to righteousness, as tell me there, as stars forever and ever. When you're a minister and you know the ministry that God has given you, that whatever you're doing, you're leading people out of sin, you're leading them to the Savior. Out of darkness, you're leading them to the light, and you're bringing them to righteousness. Their lives are being transformed. And then you lead not just one or two or 10 or 100, you lead many to righteousness. It says, shall shine like stars forever and ever. That's why he called them stars. And then he says, look at that, Revelation chapter 2, verse 1. These things says he that holdeth the stars in his right hand. He holds the stars. He holds the stars. And he holds them in his right hand. If you're a minister, the Lord will hold you. You will not fall. And you will not fail. Because the power of the Lord, when he says the right hand, that's the demonstration of the power of the Lord. And he's holding those seven stars. Psalm 119, I'm reading from verse 117. Psalm 119, we're reading from verse 117. Hold thou me up, it will hold you up. And I shall be safe. You will be safe and protected. And I will have respect unto thy statutes continually. Holding the seven stars. Holding those ministers in his right hand. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 41. Isaiah chapter 41. And I'm reading from verse 13. Isaiah chapter 41, verse 13. For I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand. Somebody there, the Lord will hold your right hand. Saying unto thee, fear not, I will help thee. And so Jesus Christ said, John, write to the church at Ephesus and tell them, here is the one that is holding the seven stars in his right hand. And then it says in Revelation chapter 2 verse 1, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. Who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. Remember, what are the seven golden candlesticks? Look at chapter 1 of Revelation verse 20. Because these are symbols and it symbolizes something. It tells us in Revelation chapter 1 verse 20, the mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand and the seven golden candlesticks. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. And look at this. And the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. What does it say? There are the seven churches. A candlestick or candlestand, the same thing. They hold the light. They hold the candles. They are not the light, but they are the holders of the light. And they show the light to everyone around. That's what the church is. The church is supposed to be the candlestick. And the candlestick that beams the light and shines the light and shows the light to everybody around. In the church should be the light of the community. That's why Jesus said, ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. And either do you light a candlestick and then put it on the bushel, but you put it on the lampstand so that it will show the light to everyone. And thank God you are part of that church. And your light will shine. And your light will shine to everybody around you. They'll know you are different in Jesus' name. But now Jesus says something. He said, I'm the one that walks in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. What does that mean? Why is it golden? Because it's precious. Why is it golden? Because it's costly. Why is it golden? Because it's priceless. That's what he's saying. He says the church is golden. The church is priceless. And the church is a treasure. And then he's showing the light to the community. And he's walking in the midst of those churches. What's the implication for you and for me? Deuteronomy chapter 23. And we're reading from verse 14. He walketh in the midst of those churches. Revelation chapter 23. And we're reading here from verse 14. It says in verse 14, for the Lord thy God walketh in the midst of thy camp. What camps are we talking about? Now 12 tribes of Israel. And they were 12 in their own case. And they ran into millions. And the Lord said, I'm walking in the midst of you. As you think about the church, we're talking about the church Jerusalem, Antioch, Philippi, and Corinth, and Galatians, everywhere now, Ephesus. And it says, I'm walking in the midst of those candlesticks and of those churches. And the Lord is saying, for the Lord thy God walketh in the midst of thy camp to deliver thee. He will deliver us. I said, he will deliver us. And to give up thine enemies before thee. Somebody said, amen. And therefore shall thy camp be holy, that you see no unclean thing in thee, and turn away from thee. It says, I walk in the midst of you. I walk and I inspect. I walk and I supervise. I walk and I analyze. I walk and I see everything that you are doing. And then you don't want him to see anything unclean, so that it will not turn away from you. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 6. 2 Corinthians. We're looking at chapter 6. It's walking in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, and we're reading from verse 16. It tells us in verse 16, and what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them and will walk in them. Will walk in them. That means he was walking among us. And then he goes on to say, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Because he's walking in the midst of the churches, that's why it says in verse 17, wherefore, come out from among them. Come out from among them. The church is the ecclesia. The church is the called out people. And you must know that you are different and distinct from the people of the world. Come out from among them, says the Lord, touch no unclean thing, and I will receive you. And I will be a father unto you. And you shall be my sons and my daughters, says the Lord Almighty. We're different from the world. We'll remain different in Jesus' name. We come to point number two now, Christ's recognition of a faithful ministry. Let's come to Revelation chapter 2, reading from verse 2. I know thy works. The one who says, I'm the one holding the seven holding the stars in my right hand. He says, I know your works. And the one who says, I've been walking around and I look at you, I look at everything that is done internally, externally, privately, publicly, your thoughts, your heart, your spirit, your mind, your action, your activity, everything. I see everything. And so he says, I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear with them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored and hast not fainted. Look at a church like this. I pray will be like this. When every member is like this, then the whole church will be like this. You know, when you have a string, a chain that is a string that has a chain, all those chains are there, the weakest link will be the strength of that whole chain, of that whole chain. But so if you're part of the church and that one is weak and that one is weak and that one is weak, the church will be weak. But when every chain, every ring there is strong, every ring there is active, every ring there is very solid, then the whole chain will be solid. If every member were like this, and God will say, and Christ will say, he comes to us one by one. He says, I've been walking around and I've been following you. I see you in your office. I see you in your family. I see you on the street. I see you in the at the train station. I see you in the plane. I see you when you travel out of the country. I see you everywhere. I know your works, and I know your labor, and I know your perseverance, and I know how you cannot bear with them that are evil, and I know that you have tried them that say they are apostles, but you find them false, you find them liars, and you are born and you have endured, and you're still patient and persevering, and for my name's sake you have labored and you have not fainted. Not only that, look at verse 6, but this thou hast, us. This is part of the commendation, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which also I hate. And this is the Lord, you know, talking to them. And let's look at it one by one. And then you look at your life, and then you look at your church, you look at your family, and you look at our whole church together. Because that's what the Lord is saying here. He's saying, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. This is for self-examination, and this is for self-evaluation. This is for you to say, God is looking at me. Christ is looking at me. Look at what he sees, and look at what he beholds, and look at what he has said. John, write to them and tell them, this is what I know about them. Number one, I know thy labor. I know thy labor. What kind of labor is that? John chapter 6. In John chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 27. John chapter 6, verse 27 is telling us here, labor not for that, for the meat which perisheth, but for that meat which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you. For him as God the Father sealed. It says, look at your labor. Are they just for bread and butter? Look at your labor. Are they for mundane things? Look at your labor. Are they for earthly certificates alone? Look at your labor. Are they for earthly things that will perish with time? But he says, labor not for that. If I'm going to say, I know your labor, and I'm going to evaluate that, I'm going to put some value on that, it must be spiritual. It must be eternal. It must be soul saving. It must be soul preserving. I know your labor. Labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for that which endures unto everlasting life. As the Lord is looking at your labor, at your contribution, at what you are doing in the kingdom, can he say that what you are laboring for is not something that will be burnt up on the final day? It is not something that will perish with time. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I'm reading from verse 10. It says in verse 10, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace which was bestowed told upon me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. He's not comparing himself to the politicians of the day. He said, I labor more abundantly than they all. It's not comparing himself to the politicians of the day when he said, labored more abundantly than they all. He's talking about the apostles. If you read from verse 1 all through this verse, he's saying those apostles, they labored in Jerusalem, they labored for salvation of souls, they labored for the expansion of the kingdom, they labored for the spread of the gospel. And he says, by grace, by grace. This is not by human attainment. By grace I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. I pray you'll have that grace too. Verse 58, therefore, my beloved brethren, he has spoken about his own labor, and he said it is spiritual. He has spoken about his own labor. He has said it is soul-saving. He has spoken about his own labor. He said it's a sanctifying labor. It's a kind of labor that prepares people for heaven. Now, he brings it to you and to me. He says, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. In the work of the Lord. This is not politics. In the work of the Lord. This is not secular. In the work of the Lord. This is something that saves souls. And when Jesus said, I know your labor. I know you are laboring to get souls saved. I know your labor. You are laboring to get them out of darkness into the light. I know your labor. And he says, for most as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Your labor will not be in vain. And then we come to number 2. Now come to Revelation chapter 2. And I'm reading from verse 3. It says, I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience. We'll come to that later. And how thou canst not bear with them which are evil. Thou canst not bear with them which are evil. You are not friendly with them which are evil. You are not sympathetic to them which are evil. You are not in fellowship with them which are evil. You are not accommodating them which are evil. And you are not giving approval to them which are evil. That's where some people, that's where they fall flat. That's why they fail the Lord. That's why they fail in the examination of the Lord, in the evaluation of the Lord. They are in a church that stands for the word of God, but they have sympathy for some friend outside that has false doctrine. They have sympathy and fellowship with some people somewhere that have false doctrine. They have a soft spot for somebody outside that is not standing on the truth. But Jesus said, when he evaluated this church, examined this church, he said, you cannot bear with them which are evil, and you have tried them. You didn't just go by their testimony. I'm an apostle, I'm a prophet, I'm a preacher, I'm a gospeler, I'm a minister, and then support the work of God, send your tithes to me, send your offering to me, I'm also doing the work of God. He said, you tried them which say the apostles and are not, and has found them liars. You see, these people, they not just take somebody's testimony, I'm born again, I'm spirit filled, I'm this and that, and they omit sanctification, they omit holiness, and if you talk about it, they'll say, nobody can be holy in this world. It says, you know, those people are liars, because God said, the word of God says, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which, tell me, no man shall see the Lord. And they say, I'm saved, and they are filled with the Holy Ghost, and there's no holiness and patience in between. And they say, but I'm serving the Lord. I know that, you know, I have this gift and this gift. You see, they examined them and they tested them, and they did not allow them to come to their pulpit and be preaching their error. You found them to be liars. And look at what the word of God is telling us, that that's exactly what we should do as well. We should not allow ourselves to be carried away with the people that have any false doctrine. Galatians chapter 2. In Galatians chapter 2, we're reading from verses 4 and 5. It says, and that because of false brethren, false prophets, false teachers, false evangelists, and false apostles, that because of false brethren, unawares brought in, who came in privately to spy out our liberty, which we have in Christ Jesus, that they might bring us into bondage, to whom we give place by subjection. Tell me, no, not for an hour. We didn't give them face. We didn't give them any kind of approval, any kind of fellowship. We said, no, not for an hour, that the truth of the gospel might continue with you. And that's the stand you ought to take if you want the truth of the gospel to continue with your children and with our children and with the younger generation. We must take our stand and not allow false prophets, false teachers, false apostles, deceivers, misleading souls into hell to have anything to do with us. This church at Ephesus, they refused them. We refused them. They resisted them. We're going to resist them. They rejected all the deceivers and all the deceitful workers. They stood firm against terror, against falsehood, and they will not compromise. Thank God, I will not compromise. Somebody there, I will not compromise. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 1. 2 Timothy chapter 1. Because, you know, if you compromise, somebody will look at you and say, oh, you brother so-and-so can't go that direction. How about me? Why am I so straight? Why am I so firm? If sister so-and-so, mommy so-and-so can go that direction, how about me? What's my problem? Why am I so strict when mommy so-and-so is not strict and daddy so-and-so is not strict? But you want to stand with the word of God? Thank God they will stand. I can't hear my people. Thank God you will stand. 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 1. Chapter 1 verse 13. Hold fast the form of sound word which thou hast heard of me in faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. And that good thing which has been committed unto thee, keep by the Holy Ghost which dwelleth in us. You will keep this word of God. We're coming to Revelation chapter 2, and I'm looking now at verse 3. It says, and thou hast borne and hast patience. That patience there is perseverance. What do we call that perseverance? They had opposition, but they patiently just continued. That's perseverance. And they had attacks. I'm not talking of a demonic attack or whatever. Children of God are free from attack. And thank God I'm free from attack. I said, thank God I'm free from attack. But you are talking about people writing against them, talking against them, and throwing criticism at them. That's the attack we are talking about. But you see, they stood and they said, whatever you say, let them say. Everybody say, let them say. You know, if they say holy, holy, all you say is let them say. And then, you know, they're the Bible people, deep alive people. They just keep to the Bible alone. And then when you hear, do you know they are talking about you? Do you know they are opposing? Do you know they are saying this and this? And then you say, let them say. You are standing in that opposition. It doesn't move you at all, because you know you're going to stand by the grace of. That's what God is looking at. He's looking at the people who are faithful. He's looking at the people that whatever their opposition, whatever their criticism, and whatever their persecution, he just shrugs his shoulder and he pushes it off behind him and says, that doesn't hurt me, that doesn't help me, that doesn't do anything to me. Let them sing. Look at it now. We're looking at chapter 2, verse 3. And has borne and has patience for my name's sake, and has labored and has not fainted. These are the people that whatever comes, whatever goes, whatever people do, however people criticize, however people oppose, they will not faint. And thank God I'm one of those people. I said I'm one of those people. I will not faint in Jesus' name. You will not faint in Jesus' name. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 1. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. We're looking at verse 1. It says, therefore seeing we have this ministry, these are ministers, which as we have received mercy, we faint not. We faint not. Somebody say, I faint not. Look at verse 16 there, verse 16 of that 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16. For which cause we faint not. For which cause, tell me, we faint not. Tell me out loud. Our church will not faint. In evangelism will not faint. In obedience to the word of God will not faint. Under persecution will not faint. When our relatives oppose us and they ridicule us and they jest about us, we will not faint. And when the people say they are different, thank God they know we're different. Thank God I'm different. I say, thank God I'm different. We will not try to convince them, no, we're not different. No, we're the same. No, we're not the same. Don't tell a lie. Don't tell a lie. Somebody who is born again is not the same as those who are not born again. Somebody who is saved is not the same as the unsaved lost people. Somebody who is sanctified and holy is not the same as the one that is chewing tobacco, smoking tobacco, and they get into drunkenness, and they are following all these women about adultery, fornication. No, we're not the same. Are you the same with them? No, we're not the same. And we're going to take that stand. And we're not going to allow their criticism, opposition, persecution to make us bend or to make us feel ashamed. I am not ashamed of Christ. I said I'm not ashamed of Christ. Thank God they know you are different. You remain different in Jesus' name. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16. For which cause we faint not. But though our old man perish, that is the bodily flesh, yet our inward man is renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Why we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. And so we're going to stand in Jesus' name. We're coming back to Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, and I'm reading from verse 6. It says, but this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Who is talking here? I said, who is talking here? You know, some people, they say, does Jesus hate anything? Does God hate anything? I thought God loves everything. Everything that goes on in our community. Everything that everybody does. I thought Jesus will just say, God bless you. God bless you. I love you. I love everything. Whatever you do, whatever you say, wherever you go, however you act, however you behave, whatever you preach, whatever you write, I love everything. I thought that's the picture people have about Jesus. Meek Jesus. Lowly Jesus. And Jesus that loves everything that goes on everywhere. He never condemns anyone or anything. But you see, look at that verse 6 again. But this thou hast, that thou, tell me, hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, tell me the rest, which I also hate, the things that God hates. We need to understand that. Look at that chapter 2 verse 15. Look at verse 15. So as thou also them that hold the doctrine, the teaching, the message, the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which sin I hate. There are people that don't make any distinction, any difference. They think that anything somebody has written on paper, whatever, they say, I don't like to condemn anybody. I don't like to oppose anybody. I will do what I'm doing and allow other people to do what they're doing. If that is the limit of their knowledge, if that is their understanding of the Christian life, who am I? Who am I? I thank God for what I know. And then let us just praise God for what everybody knows. Jesus said, no, the deeds and the doctrines of the Nicolaitans, I hate them. And it is good that you have this commendation that you also hate such a thing. But the question is, does God ever hate anything? Look at this, Deuteronomy chapter 16 verse 22. Deuteronomy chapter 16. I'm reading from verse 22. Are you opening your Bibles there? It says in chapter 16 verse 22, neither shalt thou set up any image which the Lord thy God hateth. Those who put images in their church buildings, those who put images in the yard of their church building, God says, I hate that. Because he says, thou shalt not put any image of Mary, of whoever, or even of Jesus, of whatever, of whoever, which sin, which the Lord thy God hateth. Look at Proverbs chapter 6. Proverbs chapter 6, the things that he hates. And if you're a child of God, you'll hate what he hates, and you will love only what he loves. We're looking at Proverbs chapter 6, and we're reading from verse 16. These six things does the Lord, tell me, hate. Yea, seven are an abomination unto him, a proud look. You know, there are people that have, they make up this and make up that, and then they become so pompous and proud. God says he hates that. A lying tongue, you know, somebody is going to lie on your behalf. You hate that. Say, don't do that for me. I said that to cover you up. I said that to, to protect you and to protect your integrity. And then you are smiling and say, okay, I didn't tell the lie. It's that man that told the lie on my behalf. God hates that lying tongue. And if you're a child of God, you'll hate what he hates. Hands that shed innocent blood. You know, the people that, what has that unborn baby done that they shed his blood? They shed innocent blood. You hate that. And the people that go after, they want to get money because they want to get money to kill innocent people. God says, I hate that. And heart that deviseth wicked imaginations, he hates that. And feet that are swift in running to mischief, I hate that. A false witness that speaketh lies, he hates that. And he that soweth discord among brethren, I hate that. What's that? Somebody comes to you and he knows you are friendly with so and so. He knows you are in fellowship with so and so. He knows that you respect so and so. And he comes to you and he says, can I tell you something about this person you respect? About this person you honor? You're always talking about this person as if this person, it doesn't have a fault. Don't you have eyes to see? Let me tell you something. And God, he says, he hates that. The people that sow discord among the brethren, he hates that. If you're a child of God, you'll hate what God hates. Isaiah chapter 61. I'm looking at verse 8. Isaiah chapter 61. And we're looking at verse 8. In verse 8 it says, for I the Lord love judgment, I hate robbery for burnt offering. I hate robbery for burnt offering. You know that somebody does not work at all. You know, he sits down. You see him when you are going to walk, you know, he's at house, he's in the house. He's either having his long chew stick and he's spitting here and there. By the time you come back, he's still like that. And he's not gone to work. It's in the night when everybody has gone to sleep. He goes here to rob and goes there to rob. And the man is riding, you know, luxurious cars. He's building house here, building house there. And the neighbors are saying, well, we know where he's getting his money. It's because he's a robber. And that fellow will come to their church. And when he comes to their church, he'll donate this money. And then the preachers in that church will exalt that person. You know what God says? I hate robbery for burnt offering. And somebody will say, you know, robbing this and robbing that, and is giving you money, giving you gift, and say, you know, that man is generous. Is generous, and you love that. You must hate what God hates. That's the good quality about this church. It says, because you hate what I hate. And then he prays them for that. I pray the Lord will praise us as well for such a good thing in Jesus' name. Whatever God hates, you're not going to benefit from that. Does he hate adultery? Yes. Tell me out loud. Yes. Somebody is saying to adultery. Is this a second wife? That's a third wife. And then they have now got a new baby out of that adultery. And then you have heard about that in your heart, you see. But that's second wife, that's third wife. But all the same, I must not carry religion too far. I must say, because they'll be wondering, you didn't come to greet us. You didn't come to even, you know, send us a greeting card. You didn't even come to rejoice with us. Didn't you hear? And then you are saying, what do I tell him now? And then I was planning to come. And it's just, you beat me to it. I was planning to, okay, you wait for me and see what I will do. And then they go and scribble one card and send somewhere. And their conscience telling them that, you know, God hates adultery. You know that this is not the right thing to do. Yes, Lord, but you know, if I don't do that, I'll not be a good neighbor. You want to be a good neighbor and offend the Lord. If you're a real Christian, you're well, they will say, well, you know, he's a Bible man, he's a Bible woman. You know that, you know, he knows that, you know, we're living in this kind of condition. That's why he didn't have anything to do with it. Let them talk about you. And that will prick their conscience. And that will make them, either they will repent or they say, okay, go your way. But you thank God because you are living according to what knowledge you have, according to the word of God. God will give you courage. Will give you backbone, will give you stamina, and you'll be able to obey the word of God in Jesus' name. And we're looking at Hebrews chapter 1, verses 8 and 9. Hebrews chapter 1, and I'm reading from verses 8 and 9. It tells us in verse 8, verse 9, it says, but unto the Son, he says, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is a scepter of thy kingdom. Thou hast loved righteousness. Tell me the rest. And hated iniquity. And hated iniquity. And then it says, even therefore God, even thy God, has anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. These are the rich children of God. This is the church, the ecclesia of God. Those who are out of darkness into the light. Those who are out of sin into righteousness. And those who are out of worldliness, and they are into heavenly mindedness. I pray God will make you one of them, one of us, in Jesus' name. Having the mind of Christ, we love only what he loves, and we hate what he hates. If we love what God hates, then we have another spirit, and we do not belong to the Lord. We come to point number three now. Christ's requirement of faulty messengers and fallen members. Christ's requirement of faulty messengers and fallen members. We're coming to Revelation chapter 2. And I'm reading from verse 4. It says, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Look up here for a moment. If somebody that you appreciate, somebody you love, somebody you honor, and somebody you know he loves you and honors you. And you are all excited and you say, my friend, well, there's a point we need to discuss. And then he looks serious and he says, well, I don't want to pretend I have somewhat against you. You're startled. You're unhappy. Because now he puts you right to the point and he says, yes, I know you are excited. I know you act like a friend. I know you act like somebody familiar. But I have somewhat against you. When you think about Christ, the one you have willed your life to, the one you say, I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Jesus, I surrender. And then you say, I'm following Jesus. He loves me. I love him. And you sing about him. And you talk about him. And you witness about him. And then you read the word every day. You're in devotion and everything. All of a sudden, he comes to you and he says, you know, nevertheless, you're saved. Nevertheless, you profess sanctification. Nevertheless, you evangelize, nevertheless. You say you are working for me, nevertheless. You say my mind is in heaven, nevertheless. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee. What's that? Because thou hast left thy first love. It says, I know, I can see activity, but I'm looking for affection. I can see labor, I'm looking for love. I can see your excitement. I'm looking for excellence. I can see the relationship. I can see the outward righteousness. I'm looking for something internal. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee. If you are a real child of God, okay, Christ, that's all right, don't mind, we'll settle that later. I'm now going for this. I'm going to seek. I'm going to walk. I'm going to labor. He says, come back here. If you bring your gift to the altar, and you remember, somebody has sought against you, you leave your guilt at the altar, and you go reconcile with him that has that sin against you. This is not just somebody. This is Christ. This is your Lord. This is the Savior. This is the one that is going to take you to heaven. And he's saying, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. He says, remember then. Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen. He calls it a fall. He says, you are falling from that first love and repent and do the first works. What's he talking about when he says the first love is the fervent love? The fervent love. You know, when we first met the Lord, when you were first born again, how excited you were. How serious you are. How fiery you are. Anything that concerns Jesus, you are into it. You are excited. You are enthusiastic. You are joyful. You are cheerful. And you didn't do anything sluggishly. You didn't do it just to do it to fulfill all righteousness. It was a fervent love. He said, I can't see that. I can't see that. I see labor. I see drudgery. I see activity. I see regularity. I see that by habit you do this now. But the fresh, the fervent love is gone. Number two, fresh love. Fresh love. When you first knew the Lord, how fresh it was. You never thought about something like this before. You never knew about this Jesus before. Now he saved my soul. Now he has sanctified me. And I'm going to follow him till the rest of my life. I must read my Bible before I take breakfast. I must read my Bible before I take supper. Anywhere I go, I and my Bible. And then openly, you will read the Bible excited. It says, but it's not like that anymore. You left your fresh love. It says, I can't see the full love. I can't see the full love. You have divided your heart between me and profession. You have divided your heart between me and activity. You have divided your heart between me and some people. What you are looking for, I know, yes, you still love me, but it's not like the first love. It is not the full love that loves me without reservation. That's what he's talking about. It says, I cannot see the free-flowing love. That at that time, nobody had to push you. You just did what you ought to do. And then you read the Bible like this. Sometimes you are reading the Bible. Tears are coming from your eyes. When you see how God loves me. He loves me. I cannot tell why. He loves me. And then he sacrificed for me. He's taking away all my sin. What have I done? Who am I? That Christ has done this. And Christ is saying, I cannot see that free-flowing love anymore. Because it's like, you know, somebody has to push you. And
remind you, are you going to the Bible study today? Is it time? Are we going again? Okay, I'll be there. And then you're looking at your time. They'll still be singing choruses now. Well, they might be getting to congregational song and they're also offering now. Okay, let me go. And by the time you come, we're on the third point. I still attended the Bible study. You're not committing adultery. You're not committing fornication. You're not stealing. You are not robbing. But you've left your first love. The fervent love is no more there. The fresh love is no more there. The fullness of love is no more there. The free-flowing love is no more there. And the self-forgetting love is no more there. In the past, anything you wanted to do, just forgot yourself. They say, are you not going to think of yourself and preserve some money for this and for this? You say, I've forgotten. I just love Christ. And whenever they make any announcement that the work of God needs this and needs that, I'm all for it. I've forgotten myself. But now you don't forget yourself like that anymore. Now you love yourself, you love Christ, and then you love him and you love yourself. It's like you are sharing the throne together. It was a faithful obedient love. Anything he commanded is just for you to read. Did Jesus say that? I'm for it. Did Jesus command that? I'm for that. I love him so much, I don't even bother my mind. Why did he say that? When did he say that? Who did he say that? I just read that in the Bible, and that faithful, obedient love was there. You just loved him. And Jesus said, I'm watching you. I'm watching your religion, and I'm watching the way you are doing things today. Evangelism, yes, we're going to do evangelism, but hold on. This evangelism we're talking about, have we looked at the cost and the time it's taking us and the money is taking us and the energy is taking us and all the things is taking us? You are not thinking like that before when you were first born again. Evangelism, I'm for it, let's go. And then you're going to spend your money to buy tracks, I'm for it, let's go. And then we're going to have a crusade, and we need this amount of money to do this, and then all the bank accounts you have, you say, I wish I had the money, I will pay for everything all alone by myself. It's not like that anymore. That's what Jesus is saying. He's saying, you've left your first love. It's the foremost love, the foremost love, the one that puts Christ in front and puts him as number one. Is greater than money, is greater than education, is greater than family, is greater than having children, is greater than my healing, is greater than my having deliverance, is greater than everything. We're talking about the foremost love. And Jesus is saying, I know this about you, the Ephesians church, but how about this? Now your heart is divided. We're looking at Hosea chapter 10. Hosea chapter 10, and I'm reading from verse 2. Hosea chapter 10, and we're reading here from verse 2. It says, their heart is divided, now shall they be found faulty. Their heart is divided, now shall they be found faulty. You know, when your heart is divided, it's like, you know, there are, you know, some people there, and they have their telephone with them. While the Bible study is going on, that business partner, I need to remind him that, you know, I'm going to meet him exactly at 9:30. I hope they don't overshoot at the Bible study today. And then you are sending texts and saying, I've not forgotten our appointment. 9:30, I'll be on dot, I'll be right there. Your attention is divided. Your heart is divided. And some of the people there will think they're looking at, you know, the Bible text in their telephone, because they say, you know, I've gone electronic. I'm now for, you know, all these paper Bible. I still love that. That one is in the house. But, you know, I carry my Bible in this little thing here. And we think they're looking at the Bible, but they're looking at another thing. Their heart is divided. That's what the Lord is saying. He says, you're not concentrating. You're not giving me all your attention. You're not giving me all your affection. It says their heart is divided, now shall they be found faulty. It's talking, look at Jeremiah chapter 2. Jeremiah chapter 2, and we're reading here from verse 2. Jeremiah chapter 2, and we're reading here from verse 2. It says, go and cry in the ears of Jerusalem, saying, thus says the Lord, I remember thee, the kindness of thy youth, and the love of thine espousals, when thou wentest after me in the wilderness, in the land that was not sown. Israel was holiness to the Lord. He said, I remember the fervency of the love at that time, the freshness of the love at that time, the foremost nature of the love at that time. I remember the self-forgetting love you had at that time, and your mind was always with me, and there was no wandering here and there. When you were praying, when you were listening to the Bible study, you were focused at that time. You had no other interest. This was all the interest you had. But he says now, that was in the past. Things are different now. Anything you are doing for me now, you're looking at that person, looking at that person. Does he appreciate? Doesn't he appreciate? If he doesn't appreciate, why am I doing it? You're not thinking of Christ alone. That's why he's saying that your mind is not like it used to be. Another desire has come. Another attention has come. Another thing has come to take your heart away from the Lord. It says, nevertheless, I have somewhat against you. You have left your first love. Look at Mark chapter 4. Look at Mark chapter 4. And I'm reading from verse 18. Mark chapter 4. We're looking at verse 18. It says, and these are they which are sown among the thorns, such as hear the word, and the cares of this life. That wasn't there before. The cares of this life, and the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust of other things entering in. The laws for other things and training choke the word, and it become a fruitful. It says, you know, many things now compete for your attention. This is competing for your attention. That's competing for your attention. That's competing for your attention. And then you're not thinking about me. In the past, when you had the first love, at the place of work, you'll be thinking about Jesus. Just Jesus. And once in a while, you look up and say, blessed Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. In the place of work at that time, sometimes somebody will come and then you are smiling. And the fellow just, you didn't know the fellow was coming. You were smiling. You were thinking of the promise of God and the goodness of God. And you're thinking about the fellowship you have with Jesus Christ. And then that made you to smile. And then this fellow came and then touched you. And then you say, oh. Oh, were you there? I didn't know you were there. What are you smiling? What are you thinking about? Then you say, blessed Jesus, a wonderful Jesus. And they say, he's calling Jesus as if he's the only one that knows about this Jesus. That's what we're talking about. And Jesus said, you're no more like that. Now you're dry. You're no more like that. You're no more prayerful. You're no more like that. You're no more touching me. I'm no more touching you. And the freshness that was there before, and the goodness that was there before, is no more there. The cares of this life, the deceitfulness of riches, and the laws for other things entering in has choked the word, and it becomes unfruitful. We're looking at John chapter 21. John chapter 21, and I'm reading from verse 15. John chapter 51, verse 15. So when they had died, Jesus says unto Simon Peter, Simon, 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 son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? Lovest thou me more than this? It says, Simon, Peter, I remember that the first time I met you, I said, do you have any meat? Have you got any? He said, no. And then I said, throw your net there. And you threw the net there. And then you caught a multitude of fish. You left everything. Then you faced me and said, Lord, depart from me. I'm a sinful man. I said, okay, follow me. I'll make you fishers of men. You abandoned that thing and then you followed me. You didn't even calculate. You didn't even number. What am I leaving behind? And then later you told me, Lord, we have left all and we have followed thee. What shall we have? But now you're not leaving all. It's very difficult for you today to leave anything. And he says, do you love me more than these? You know, in the past, make restitution. Once the Lord said, did you say that? Was that wrong? I'm sorry. And then you go back. I said something. I told you something yesterday. And you know that I didn't think through. This is the real truth. But now you're no more sensitive like that. And it says, lovest thou me more than this? Do you love me more than yourself? Do you love me more than fish? Do you love me more than market? Do you love me more than money? Do you love me more than all the things of this? Do you love me more than politics? Do you love me more than all the games? If they are playing games now, in the past, whatever game they were playing, even if they were playing in your front yard or at your backyard, you leave that and run to the Bible study. But today they are going to make announcement or so and so on, the governorship election, and I'm interested. And you know, today's Bible study, please, if you go, get the outline for me, because today I want to see to the end of this thing. That's your mind today. And the Lord is asking, lovest thou me more than this? And that's what the Lord is calling us back. We're going to get back. We get back to that fresh love, to that fervent love, and to that self-forgetting love that will know that he is the foremost, he is the number one, he is the highest in our lives. Come back here to Revelation chapter 2, and I'm reading from verse 5. Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen. Recall, remember, recollect all that he did at that time, and all he was to you at that time, and repent and say, Lord, I'm sorry, Lord, I'm sorry. I come back to you with all my heart, all my soul, all my mind. I turn back unto you and do the first works. And do the first works. How will the fresh love come back? How will the fervent love come back? It says it's not by just sitting and say, I want to feel the first love. No, it says you will do what you are doing at that time. If you are waking up to pray at that time, do that. Let your will come into it and do the first works and wake up and pray. If you were reading the Bible at that time, wake up and read the Bible. And whatever you are doing at that time, you are talking to me even without kneeling down to pray. At that time, you are going on the road. You are conversing with Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I love you. I appreciate you. I honor you. I exalt you. You are the Lord of my life. You are the King of my life. You did this for me. Wonderful. You are praying. Even though you are not opening your mouth, you are walking on the street and you are thinking about Christ and talking to Christ. And whatever interested Christ, that's whatever interested you. And then that's why it says, do the first works again. Number one is to remember. Number two is to repent. Number three is to repeat and say, God, I come back. Lord, I come back. Lord, I come back. And you do those first works again. And as you come back, the Lord will begin that love relationship with you again in Jesus' name. Lamentation, I'm reading from chapter 3, verse 40. Lamentation, we're looking at chapter 3, and we're looking at verse 40. Lamentation, chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 40 here. In Lamentation, chapter 3, verse 40, it says, let us search and try our ways. Let us search and try our ways. Where have we gone wrong? Where have we missed it? Where have we allowed other things to come in that has taken our first love? Let us search and try our ways and turn again to the Lord. We'll do that. I said we'll do that. It'll be the Lord of our lives. He'll be the glory of our lives. He'll be the one we're thinking about, the one we're talking to every time, and the one we're preaching about every time. We'll be excited about him. Once again, we'll forget every other thing and forget ourselves and be lost in the affection and the love, in the glory, in the honor, in the beauty of the Lord Jesus. Once again, in Jesus' name. Let us search. Let us try our ways and let us return back to the Lord. Can we do that now? Can we do that today? Can we, with all sincerity, with all our heart, pour out our hearts to the Lord and say, Lord, I know you know my heart. I love you. I want to love you more. And I want to love you more than I even love you at the very beginning. It will happen. Let's rise up and tell the Lord, I love the Lord. I want to love him. I love the Lord. I want to love him with all my heart, all my soul, all my mind. I want to love the Lord more than ever before. Let that fresh love come back. Let that fervent love come back. Let that full love come back. Let that foremost love come back. Let that faithful, obedient love come back. Let that self-forgetting love come back. Let that free-flowing love come back. Lord, I love you. Lord, I love you. Lord, I love you. If you have not loved the Lord Jesus before, you are not born again, this is the time to come and say, Lord, I surrender my life to you. And then you are born again. If you are a child of God, come back now. Love him. Love him. Love him. Love him.